Well, good morning. Hi, good morning. Good morning. I'm sure I've already seen you once this morning. So, welcome to the Dove, and at home as well, if you are watching at home, welcome as well. So my daily bread reading, which I wouldn't say I do every day, but I do have those readings at home for today, which is Sunday the 27th of December, is entitled The Best Laid Plans. The Best Laid Plans. And it invites me to think back over the past year and to consider what joys and sorrows it has held. And it also asks me, and perhaps this is the important bit, how have I seen God's work, God's hand at work in and through those joys and sorrows? So this morning I want to just consider that for a few moments and ask you, invite you, I guess, to consider the same things as well. Those two same questions. And as we do so, we're going to look for just a few moments at Psalm 127, actually just really the first two verses. But what we will do is read it all, because it's not a long psalm, and it might be that the other verses really speak to you as well. And that would be good if it did. So let's read Psalm 127. Unless the Lord builds the house, the builders labour in vain. Unless the Lord watches over the city, the guards stand watch in vain. In vain you rise early and stay up late, toiling for food to eat, for he grants sleep to those he loves. Children are a heritage from the Lord, offspring a reward from him. Like arrows in the hand of a warrior are children born in one's youth. Blessed is the man whose quiver is full of them. They will not be put to shame when they contend with their opponents in court. So as I said, we're looking really at the first two verses of that psalm, Psalm 127. And apparently, according to my daily reading anyway, and I did actually Google this as well, and it was actually true, the words of verse 1 are inscribed in Latin into the stone floor of the Palace of Westminster's central lobby, actually inscribed in the floor. So it says in Latin, inscribed in the floor, unless the Lord builds the house, the builders labour in vain. Unless the Lord watches over the city, the guards stand watch in vain. And I thought, wow, that's interesting. Why? Well, they were put there, apparently, according to Google, to purposely remind the UK's parliamentarians, when it was built, of all that all their planning and all their work is futile if it's not done in the name of God. Morning. Good morning. And even today, in the Palace of Westminster, the day-to-day activities, they still acknowledge and remember God, because apparently, again, before every sitting in both the House of Commons and in the House of Lords, they say prayers, they read prayers. And I think that's really quite exciting. I hadn't realised and never really thought about it, but I suppose when you think about it, why not? Earthly empires come and go, but the words and the work of God is eternal. So as we approach the close of this year, however we're feeling, I'm sure many of us will be very pleased to do that, with hope that next year will be a better one in so many different ways. If we are in the habit of making New Year's resolutions, and I will say I'm not in the habit of doing that for various reasons, but they will be completely worthless if we are trying to meet our own goals in our own strength. We can, of course, prepare wisely and work willingly. But unless we are working in line with what God wants us to do, in line with his will, then we'll never achieve anything of value. But there's also a flip side to all of that, and that is to say that it's futile, it's pointless to worry about our success or failure in what we're planning to do or hoping to do. And this is where we come to look at verse 2 of this psalm. It says, "In vain you rise early and you stay up late, toiling for food to eat. He grants sleep to those he loves." So thinking about this verse, I immediately thought, oh good, that means I don't have to do anything. It's all going to happen for me. Of course, it doesn't actually mean that. It doesn't really mean that at all. It doesn't say we shouldn't work for our living. We all pretty much have to do that at some point in our lives. We need money to live and to eat. That's how our country works. That's how our life works. But what it does tell us is that worrying about our lives, what we eat and drink, what we will wear. Do you remember what it says in Matthew chapter 6? It talks about the birds, doesn't it? He looks after them. We shouldn't be worrying. To worry about these things is to take the problems that we have out of our loving Father's very large and capable hands and into our own very much weaker hands. So we shouldn't do that. We need to entrust our future to God and to trust him with us. So on a little piece of paper, which is tucked inside the cover of my very first Bible, which was a Good News Bible, which I bought in 1977, so a very long time ago. I even remember where I bought it from, that shop in Hanley that's not far from the Methodist Chapel. I was only 17 at the time, and it was just a few weeks after my mother had died. Left me really devastated, that did, completely devastated, very confused about life and the future. But it was also at that time that I became a Christian, within a very short time after she died, a proper Christian. And there are some words tucked inside that cover of that Bible. They're still there on the bookshelf, and they mean a lot to me. My mother died just a few days after Christmas. So again, it's just at this time of year that these words came about. And it says, it's not a Christian phrase, but it's not from the Bible, but it has reference to it. "I said to the man who stood at the gate of the year, 'Give me a light, that I may tread safely into the unknown.' And he replied, 'Go into the darkness and put your hand into the hand of God, and that will be to you better than light and safer than a known way.' Now, that walk that I started just then has lasted more than 40 years now, and it's almost as many years in total that my mother lived in her whole life. And I'm really grateful that I found God at that time and put my trust in him. And as I walk into this coming year, it is with that same thought of keep on trusting and keep on holding on, because that's all any of us can do. Now, I don't really have anything else particularly to share with you this morning. That's pretty much it. I hope that what I've said has come from God. I really do hope it has. And I hope it encourages you as you offer your lives this coming year into his hands, very large and capable hands, and ask him to give you the grace and trust to build your life this year into his perfect will. Back at the end of June, and it was a lovely service that Peter gave, Peter Brassington. It was towards the end of the first part of lockdown, so we were still all at home watching online. He gave us a music video to watch. It was the UK Blessing, but it was sung in 15 different languages, which was relevant to what he said. So we're going to watch another version of that again. And this time it's sung all in English, but it's very wonderfully sung by lots and lots of different UK churches. And I watched this on video at home about a week before Christmas, and I realised that and this was when I last looked at it, just before Christmas, it had already had almost 4.5 million views. A lot of people have been watching this video. And there were 5,811 comments made, really positive comments. I didn't look at them all, but I looked at several pages. And they were made from people all over the world. And it just goes to show what a wonderful thing God is already doing, not just what he's going to do next year, but what he's already doing to encourage those who need encouragement. And the other thing, really, just before we watch it, is to say how encouraged I was that it gave me such a lot of hope and joy that we are part of something massive. As I look around this building just now, half a dozen people and children, lovely as well, that's wonderful. But it's not what I want to see. I want to see the place full. But people are watching at home, and we have to remember that. And we have to also remember that even in this country alone, there are Christians who are here supporting us, and we're supporting them. And that's to say nothing of those in the world out there too, in the wider world. So let's enjoy this video now. Thank you. Thanks, Julie.
From heaven, this isn't second guessing. We know that we are protected. May the peace that surpasses all understanding be our message. Grace and favors in your nature, in your essence.
May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and the children, and the children, may his favor be upon you, and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children, may his favor be upon you, and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children, may his favor be upon you, and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children, may his presence go before you, and behind you, and beside you, all around.
I'd like to just really just invite us within our little groups here now just to have a short time of prayer, sharing. Maybe why don't we just tell each other what we want God to do for us this year, or what we hope to do with God this year. And if we haven't got anything to say, what we would like to pray for other people, of course. Now, use the microphone if you want to. I do have a prayer that I'm going to speak on the video in a short while, but I'd like us to have just a bit of a time of praying and sharing now between us. Thank you. Father God, as we stand at the gate of a new year of 2021, we thank you that you stand with us. We thank you that you know the future. We thank you that, in the words of Philippa Hannah, you are God and we are not. We thank you for that, Father. Father, keep us under the shadow of your wings, and sustain and support all those who are fearful or anxious for their future. Father, we ask you that you would lift up all those who have been brought low in the last year, whether because of the pandemic or maybe just because of other things, the things of life, the stuff of life that happens to us. Father, please have your hand on all those who are sad and grieving today because of people that they've lost this year. Help us each one to move on and to say, God is a God in whom I will trust. I will hold his hand and I'll let him lead me into 2021 and the years to come beyond that too. And help each of us, Lord, to know that, to know this with all certainty, that nothing can ever remove us or stop us from being under your protection, under your safekeeping, your power and your love. For those who are watching on video now, maybe it's a good time to press your pause button and just take a few moments to spend a little bit of time praying for those that you love and to ask God to care for them and to care for you too. And so now let us just conclude this time of prayer by saying the words of the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
God, your love never changes. I just pray that you would be present, Lord, in what I've got to say this morning, Father, and that, Father, when we go from here, Father, that we just walk closer with you. In Jesus' name. So what a year it's been. So looking back, I think we can say with absolute certainty that nothing has gone as expected. And nothing really has gone as we would have hoped either, I don't think. I was saying a year ago that I was looking for 10 new people worshipping in the church this year and some baptisms. And here we are this morning, a year on, and there's 8 of us. Also, and that's right. Events took an unexpected turn, and we spent a large part of this year with our doors closed. And my vision hasn't changed. It's still there. And during this year, God has reminded us through Peter and again through Lucy of our original vision. To take the love of God to the Dove Valley. And that's what we were kind of here for, really, in Lucy's words, to prophesy to the dry bones of the Dove Valley. And, you know, looking back, you know, we can say that we don't appear to be much further on with that than we were. But where do we go from here? So a year ago, I laid a challenge down, and I want to repeat it now. I was talking about Moses from Exodus 34. Moses and the leaders of Israel went up the mountain to be with God, and they stopped partway up the mountain. That there's this moment where they stop and they're together, and there's a feast. They have this feast in the presence of God. And they worship God there. And then Moses goes up to the top of the mountain to be with God. And the rest of the people, they're kind of worshipping from a distance. And then they go back down the mountain. And Moses is up on the mountain with God. And he's there for 40 days and 40 nights, 6 weeks. And the people lost sight of God. Because Moses, their leader, wasn't there. He'd gone. I don't know where he'd gone. 6 weeks, he disappeared. They just assumed that God had taken him, I suppose, or he'd died. Or maybe he just left. Found something better to do. And then Moses returned. He came back down the mountain with the tablets of stone from God. And the people are worshipping a golden calf. We looked a year ago at Psalm 27, and I just want to read verse 4. One thing I've asked of the Lord, and that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, and gaze upon the beauty of the Lord, and to inquire in his temple. Whatever we aspire to do, for God in this place would come out of our worship. It's always been the case, and it is still the case. And by worship, I mean the desire that we have to be in His presence, to gaze upon His beauty. That one thing will be what inspires us, what gets us out of bed in the morning. So what is your one thing this morning? What's your one thing? What is it that gets you out of bed in the morning? What is it that inspires you? What's your one thing? For David, it was to be in the presence of God, to gaze upon His beauty, to inquire in His temple. Because that is the thing that motivates us, and that is what will ultimately come out of us. 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 to 9. All praise to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. It is by His great mercy that we have been born again. Because God raised Jesus Christ from the dead. And now we live with great expectation. And we have a priceless inheritance. An inheritance that is kept in heaven for you. Pure and undefiled. Beyond the reach of change and decay. And through your faith, God is protecting you by His power until you receive His salvation, which is ready to be revealed on the last day for all to see. So be truly glad, for there is wonderful joy ahead, even though you must endure many trials for a little while. These trials will show that your faith is genuine. It is being tested as fire tests and purifies gold, though your faith is far more precious than mere gold. So, when your faith remains strong through many trials, it will bring you much praise and glory and honor on the day when Jesus Christ is revealed to the whole world. You love Him, although you have never seen Him. Although you do not see Him now, you trust Him and you rejoice with a glorious, inexpressible joy. The reward for trusting Him will be the salvation of your souls. Personally, I want to end this year strong. I want to end this year strong. It's been a tough one, and we've all been battered. We've lost friends. Others have been struggling with circumstances. We've seen brothers and sisters stumbling in their faith. And we didn't see any of this coming. Beginning of 2020, well, we were talking about 2020 vision. We're not out of it yet. Maybe there's some hopeful signs, but we've still got a way to go. But the point is this, and Sharon reminded us, He's still God. You are still God. He's still God. So let's remind ourselves of that fact again. Whatever is going on in this world, whatever my circumstances appear to be, He is still God. He hasn't changed. He doesn't change. Verses 3 to 5. All praise to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, for it is by His great mercy that we've been born again, because God raised Christ from the dead. Now we live with great expectation, and we have a priceless inheritance, an inheritance that is kept in heaven for you, pure and undefiled, beyond the reach of change and decay. Through your faith, God is protecting you by His power until you receive this salvation, which is ready to be revealed on the last day for all to see. We have a greater purpose and context than our immediate circumstances. I mean, isn't that brilliant news? It is by His great mercy that we've been born again, because God raised Christ from the dead. We've been reading in Ephesians. I've been getting a lot out of this Ephesians study, actually. It's been quite challenging. But I've been getting a lot out of it. And if you've not been following it online, I do recommend that you do. We've nearly finished it now, actually. We read it in Ephesians that God raised Christ from the dead and seated him in the ultimate place of power at his right hand, the executive position. And he's brought us to life and raised us up and seated us there with him. We are born again. We have an identity in Christ. This is who we are. We don't belong to this world. We're in the world. Inevitably, we're in the world. And we suffer the world's emergencies. That's a thing. But this is not our home. We're here to establish a foothold, a bridgehead of God's kingdom. This is what we're doing. To be his light in the midst of darkness. Now we live with great expectation, Peter says. We have a priceless inheritance, an inheritance that is kept in heaven for you, pure and undefiled, beyond the reach of change and decay. Even if we lose everything in this life, we are hid with Christ in God, that's Colossians 3. We share in his inheritance. It's eternal. Our wealth, our substance, who we are, is not subject to change. It's pure and undefiled and beyond the reach of change and decay. That's who we are. That's us. That's what we're made of. That's our substance. In Christ, because we're seated with him, he's raised us up, he's brought us to life. Paul writes to the Ephesians, you were dead, but God, who's rich in mercy, has made us alive together with Christ and seated us with him in heavenly places. We are in him, pure and undefiled, beyond the reach of change and decay. So don't despair, be truly glad. Verse 6. There's a wonderful joy ahead, even though now you must endure many trials for a while. These trials will show that your faith is genuine, that it's being tested as fire tests and purifies gold. Though your faith is far more precious than mere gold. So when your faith remains strong through many trials, it will bring much praise and glory and honor in the day when Jesus Christ is revealed to the whole world. So be truly glad. We can rejoice in this. When Jesus was born, the angels sang, glory to God in the highest, peace on earth, peace on earth. There are many challenges, many setbacks, many conflicts. God is working his purpose out. That old hymn, isn't it? God is working his purpose out as year succeeds to year. And he's uniting all things in Christ. And he's given us this ministry of reconciliation. 2 Corinthians 5. I said last year that I wanted us to be missional. I still do. Peter corrected me. He said, he pointed out that God is missional. He sends us. He's the one with the mission. He sends us. He sent us here. If you can believe that. We are here. Because he's put us here. He's sent us to this place now for this time. You might want to ask him, why. It would be an appropriate thing to ask him why. You can do that. You can ask God difficult questions. That's fine. He welcomes. Actually, when we come to God and ask him difficult questions, that's a welcome thing for him. It means we're engaging with our faith. Why? What's this about? What's going on? I had a plan. We can rejoice in the midst of trial and even in darkness because we trust that God has got hold of it and us too. Peter says, not Brussington. Be truly glad. There is wonderful joy ahead, even though you must endure many trials for a little while. These trials will show that your faith is genuine. It's being tested as fire tests and purified gold, though your faith is far more precious than mere gold. So when your faith remains strong through many trials, it will bring you much praise and glory on the day when Jesus Christ is revealed to the whole world. If our one thing is to seek out God and worship him in his temple, where is his temple? Yes, we're his temple. We're his temple. We are his temple. Not this building. We are his temple. If our one thing is to seek out God and to worship him in his temple, this is reason to rejoice. This is how we know him. This is how we draw close. James 4 verse 8 says this. Draw near to God and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, you double-minded. Okay? Draw near to God and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. That sounds a bit strong. But the thing is that we are worshipping God in his temple. He's made us a holy temple. Talking to Sharon earlier about the work she does. Ministry of reconciliation. And simply being yourself and speaking truth in love and letting what's inside come out and not forcing the issue and not making a big deal of it, but simply being who you are. And he's made us holy. We are holy. We are the place, we are the place where heaven touches earth, where God is seen. And all we have to do is be it. God said to Moses in Exodus 34, which I was speaking about last year, if you could remember. I listened to the thing on the website. He said, come up here and be. Come up here and be. Be with me on the mountain. I am, you be. And he wants us to be with him in his place, in his space, in his temple. We are his temple. We are the dwelling place of God on earth. He just wants us to be that and to meet him there, to meet him in this place. And that's brilliant. So if we've got, you know, if we're double-minded about it, if we're trying to keep one foot in the kingdom of God and one foot in the world, we're going to fall over. You can't be in that place. You can't be double-minded about it. You can't waver in this thing. We have to be who we are and not hold back. Draw near to God and he will draw near to you. We might think that we draw close in those moments of worship when we feel his presence and it's beautiful. And, you know, one of the things that I've really missed this year is that. And in fact, it's interesting, listening to one of Peter's talks from earlier in the year too. He mentioned, he actually enjoys actually Worshipping here. Why worshipping here? Because we sing some of the oldest songs. We have this broad vocabulary of worship. And I've missed that. I've missed that. Simply being able to sing to one another, to encourage one another. You know, it's scriptural. It's right. And sometimes you have those moments when you're just in the presence of God and you feel His presence, that warm presence. But that's not really it. It's lovely and it's beautiful, but that's not really it. We draw close in the tough times. When He seems a long way off, and everyone else seems a long way off too. In spite of our best efforts, the world seems to keep falling apart. It's when we don't see God, but we remember that He's still God, and we worship Him anyway. And we determine to worship Him in His temple and to draw close to Him and to seek His face and to delight ourselves in Him. Even when we can't see Him and even when He seems far away and even when we're getting nothing back from it, that's when we draw close to God. That's when we draw close to God. Verses 8 and 9. You love Him even though you've never seen Him. Though you do not see Him now, you trust Him and you rejoice with a glorious and inexpressible joy. The reward for trusting Him will be the salvation of your souls. We love Him because He loved us first and because He loved us to the end. His love never fails. One thing I've desired of the Lord, and that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in His temple. Let us be in that place today and every day. Let us dwell in the house of the Lord and gaze upon His beauty, even though we don't literally see Him. And we do this in prayer, and we do this through the scriptures. The more we gaze upon Him, the more of His mystery He reveals to us, and this builds trust. So let's trust Him and rejoice with this deep and inexpressible joy. As the King James puts it, those of us who grew up with the King James, though now you see Him not, yet believing you rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory. Wow, what a language that is. Joy unspeakable and full of glory. This is our salvation. This is our salvation. We're reading this book, I mentioned it last time, Working with Broken People, Paul Lloyd. And he talks about filling the cracks with gold. So that God takes broken people and turns them into something even more beautiful than they were before. But it's this idea that God transforms us. He transforms us. He doesn't just reform us. It's not that He picks us up and puts us back on our feet and sets us back onto where we were before we fell down. I mean, that's all right. But He transforms us. He builds something new. He makes something different. He reinvents us. He gives us a new life and a new identity. We are born again. He's put His Spirit in us. He's made us His holy place. That's the incredible thing. That's the incredible thing. We look at each other and we look at ourselves and we think, we don't think much, really, to be honest. You know, we're just a bunch of flaky people. But that's not what God sees, and it's not what He's done. He's done something amazing in us. He's brought us to life. We're born again. We are in Christ, seated with him in heavenly places. We have an eternal hope that's not subject to changing circumstances. And we have a calling. We have a mission, a ministry of reconciliation. I want to spend some time next year unpacking that. And God, our Father, has brought this back again to us, this idea that we have a purpose. He's placed us here for a purpose. He's given us a job to do. And he showed us that while everything seemed to be falling apart in the middle of 2020, when it wasn't looking too good. We can draw close to him because he's drawn close to us. And most of all, best of all, he is still God. Even when we're unbelieving, he's still God. When we're desperate for our healing, he's still God. Let's pray again. Father, we're tired. And perhaps, Lord, we're a bit disheartened. And at Christmas, Lord, we remember and we celebrate the coming of Christ, of light into this world of darkness. And we rejoice. Please shine in our hearts, Lord, as we go from here. Be our light and be our salvation. May your kingdom come and may your will be done. Right here, in us and among us, as it is in heaven, we're still God. Amen. Can we have that song?
So many people drifting away. How we need to understand. You're still God. Even when we're unbelieving, you're still God. When we're desperate for our healing, you're still God. You're still God. You're still God. You're still God. Even when our friends desert us, you're still God. Even through the things that hurt us, you're still God. You're still God. So I will be still and know you are God. Where, oh, where's your kingdom, oh God? We have let holiness go. So many idols litter our land. We've got to let this nation know. You're still God. When the government has no answers, you're still God. When the media lowers its standard, you're still God. You're still God. You're still God. You're still God. When the plans we make are worthless, you're still God. When we lose our sense of purpose, you're still God. You're still God. So I will be still and know you are God. really be seen through the church that bears his name. Agents of his kingdom, his peace in the world for which he came. You're still God, even though you were rejected, you're still God. Though you were ridiculed, deserted, you're still God. You're still God. You're still God. You're still God. Though you suffered execution, you're still God. Oh, you're alive in Christ, our champion. You're still God, yeah. You're still God. So I will be still and know you are God.
It's quite easy to speak words. Father, I pray that your word will live in us, Lord. Keep us firm, Lord, in Christ. Keep us anchored, Lord. Keep us, Lord, seeking you, Father. Remind us, Lord, that you're still God. Shall we say the grace together? The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with us all evermore. Amen.